Thank you, Ravi, for having me here. I think it's a real privilege to be talking to so many innovators and people who have really changed or shaped, I would say, healthcare in the last 50 years. And as in the last 3 hours, what I realized that a lot is happening in this space which we are not connected. In fact, if we have to really build this strongly, a lot more doctors and professionals need to be in this hall, and we all need to really work together to make the difference and accelerate the whole process. So as you have mentioned, I've talked about the clinical perspective, and I bring greetings from Max oncology team. So we are 100 plus oncologists working together. We have across 10 hospitals in Max Healthcare. We are the largest piece within Max Healthcare, which serves the clinical piece. And I would say that last year we treated 28,000 cancer patients. So that will give you a perspective of the richness, and our program is actually organ-based, specialized. We had 88 publications last year from the group as a whole. So it's a continuous process of evolution which we're working, and we work very closely with the researchers and innovators in this space. So as Ravi was saying, that there was a lot of hope and then it all died down. And then suddenly COVID brought it back. And I was thinking that actually there's a lot of possibility, but that possibility will remain a possibility unless we really leverage that power. And that is why I put this question to start with, that is this just hype? Are we going to die down with these variables and just monitoring heart rates and all this? Or actually we'll take it down to real serious business in healthcare? And that is where I would talk about. And being an oncologist, my 90% of conversation will be around oncology only. So good news is that cancer mortality is coming down year by year. In the last 30 years, the mortality has come down significantly in every cancer space. And the reasons are different. Unfortunately, quantified self has not yet shown up. There's no real impact of quantified self, so to say, to change the oncology outcomes or the perspective, except for whatever data we use in research and whatever planning we do according to that. But the day-to-day monitoring, the day-to-day impact, which is possible, has not yet shown up. So if that also shows up, then you can imagine what is possible. And that is what I will focus on. So just a brief spectrum that what we see in clinics or what we see in oncology space, there's something called preventive oncology. So to your surprise, every year we treat 15 lakh cancer patients in India, of which 50% is preventable. And that is where healthcare, quantified self can play a significant role. 50% is preventable. I'll talk about it just screening, another 20-25% can be screened. Then we come to the diagnosis and staging. That is where the decision making, that is the intent of treatment is cure or palliation, what should come in first, what should, all that plays out. And then the multidisciplinary team sits down, the surgeon, medical, radiation oncology, pathologist, radiologist, the whole jing bang has to really think through what is that best plan for this patient, then deliver the plan, and after that delivery of the plan, we don't know who will respond and who will not respond to that treatment. Still, there's a big chunk of patient population which will not respond, and that is where the whole thing is. So what are the real opportunities? I would say the real opportunities to start with prevention and screening and early detection is really very big piece. Almost 70% of the whole oncology problem will get addressed only if we focus on this first line. The delay in diagnosis is what I has mentioned as early detection. The delay happens today in India, even after in 2023, almost 70% people present in stages 3 and 4, where in developed countries today, that number is hovering around 30-35%. So we can actually change the whole thing and accelerate much faster in that space. Difficulty in understanding the uniqueness of each tumor. As I mentioned, we make a plan, then we execute that plan, and still we don't know which one will respond and which not respond. That's the uniqueness of tumor which we are, and then bringing out side effects of the treatment. So if I talk about prevention and early detection, So that is where, as I mentioned, that a good chunk of patients, I think this is not working, but anyways, So prevention, as I would say that, as I mentioned, tobacco and alcohol constitute a big part of that. Besides that, diet, exercise is a very important component. Today, diet, exercise, obesity, and high BMI, if I put club all this together, constitutes about 10 to 12% of preventive part of cancer. Forget about the impact on cardiac and vascular and other diseases. So that is one thing. And actually, I wanted to talk specifically about, So this is about the risk identification from the hereditary and familial cancer point of view. That's another segment which is possible. But the thing which I want to bring to the notice of this audience is the impact of mobiles and TV screens, which is happening in every household, in every age group, in every segment. And I think when people started realizing the impact of tobacco on lung cancer, oral cancer, other cancers, it took us 40 years to develop laws against it. What I am seeing in the clinic today is the impact of the mobiles and the screens, which is impact leading to insomnia, mental health issues, and immune system getting impacted. And this is a new epidemic in the making. I think it is time for us to wake up. We all see children with 1 year olds, 2 years old, with a mobile phone playing, and then they're eating their food. All of us had different devices where people were pulled into it. But I think that, and I've seen even young people coming with complaining about their parents and 70-year-olds that they are all hooked to their mobile phone with games and not sleeping, and therefore their whole cycle of day cycle is gone for a toss. And this is not impacting just the sleep. It's impacting the whole metabolism. It has impact on the immune system and a lot more. So I think this audience especially must be aware of this, and there's a need to work towards getting for laws against usage of this and how we can control it. Now, delay in diagnosis. So what should be screened is another issue, that what should be an adequate health problem. I think I'll not touch upon that. Apps for self-monitoring and health issues are very critical, and they will come and play a major role. But overall, what where actually the opportunity lies is in creating the general practitioner as a super oncologist and a super cardiologist and nephrologist. That is where a big opportunity lies as we connect the digital world together and create these clinics, more empowered clinics, where the empowered, the quantified self will be able to connect with that GP and will be able to load a lot of self data, and together this can change the game. So remember why cancer treatment gets delayed or delayed in diagnosis, because the symptoms are very big, there are multiple organs, the signs are very late, and therefore nobody really thinks of this as an impending crisis till it really shows up in the face. My boss, Dr. Krishnamurti, used to say that people think of cancer only when the ward boy starts thinking of cancer. That means unless the growth is too big, or even when we see these ads, they talk about big ulcers. No, the cancer started when it was very small. It takes almost 6 months' time for migration to happen from a small nodule to a big ulcer. But we lose that opportunity. And today, there's a possibility or an opportunity where we can think of universal tumor markers in blood samples, which is easy to access. And this is something which is around the corner. I'm quite hopeful. This is a slightly complicated, but I just want to show a point that the tumor cell from a zero or a very small number till the time it shows up in the clinic, the time it has undergone 32 doublings and the size of 1 gram weight or a 1 cubic centimeter volume, it has already been undergone 32 doublings. 7/8 of its natural life has been completed. From that point where it can be diagnosed by a clinician to the time when it is a lethal mass, when it can kill the person, only 4 more doublings have to happen. That means the natural life of the tumor has been completed 7/8 before it shows up. So the only opportunity we have when we intervene early, and that is why the societies where there's awareness, screening, and all this active engagement in healthcare, where they pick up early, otherwise you lose that window and we lose that chance. This is just to show that how in different cancer, for example, in breast cancer, when the tumor volume is rather insignificant or preventive part is low body weight, low BMI, no smoking, exercise, all this, or in lung cancer, where smoking and tobacco constitutes 85% of lung cancer, or in oral cancer, again, significant role. So likewise, in different parts, unless you're part of a screening program, there's a very little opportunity that you'll pick up the cancer in stage one. And that is where we lose a lot of our battles. So this is where, and also remember that how it impacts the quality of life and also the cost of treatment goes up significantly. So if you look at this whole impact in terms of survival and the screening value, I would say this is a tool, artificial intelligence tool, which can be incorporated in a GP clinic, which can be embedded through the cycle of the treat of the awareness, or the quantified self can be utilized appropriately, where we can combine, connect the imaging, the data from other data points, and club all that together to do a risk stratification, to do an analysis, and see what best can be done to pick it up early. Now, what is happening in terms of the universal tumor marker, which I was talking about, or a sample from the blood, which can change the game, and which is, this is also something which is already in clinical practice to some extent, though not widely practiced. The opportunity for us here is to make this really cheap and effective, and there's a big game changer. Here, what happens when the tumor cells die, or necrosis, apoptosis happens, they are released into the blood and the circulation. And these dead RNAs can be picked up by blood sample, and that can lead to early detection. Now, this is at all points possible. Early detection in terms of screening, it's possible to see, evaluate whether the treatment was completely effective, the tumor was eliminated, or third is to pick up early recurrences. And this is something which is already showing an impact, though not so widely used. So, because of the cost factor, and this is where the opportunity lies to make it happen. I think the time that's showing is already 10 minutes over, but I will just take another 3-4 minutes. So the big opportunity here is also that, remember that a lot of these areas we are not able to access for biopsy. For example, a lung lesion to biopsy, you need a CT guide biopsy to reach there. And in spite of that, how many cores can you take? Because the risk of pneumothorax, there's a risk of other issues. Likewise, an endoscopic procedure from a gastric cancer or rectal cancer or colonic cancer, you take one punch, the possibility of getting a positive biopsy is only about 85-86%. You have to take 6 or 7 punches to actually be sure that it's 97-98% certainty that you'll get a tissue for adequate diagnosis. Whereas in a blood sample, the possibility is even higher. So this whole thing about liquid biopsy is going to change the whole thing in a very big way, and is happening. So it is finally going to be a balance between the uncontrolled cells of the cancer cells and the host response, that is, this leads to the development of cancer. The risk always in all these scenarios is that sometimes you'll be over-treating patients because you pick up disease which may never show up clinically. So as more and more data will accumulate, we will all educate ourselves, we'll know what to do and what not to do. So there'll be a journey through this, but I'm sure there's a lot of opportunity there. So if I talk about the quantified tumor now. So we all have heard, every time a cancer patient comes to us, the first question they will ask, Dr. Sahab, mara stage kya? What's my stage of cancer? Whatever they understand or don't understand, this fear that staging is crucial, that is actually the quantification of the tumor. What's the tumor's extent? Where it is located? What is the number of cells? So while we classify in stages 1, 2, 3, and 4, broadly speaking, in simple terms for us, stage 1 means localized early cancer, stage 2 means localized bulky cancer, stage 3 means local regional cancer, and stage 4 means metastatic cancer. But the reality is that almost 10-15% of stage 1 behave like stage 4. And almost 10% of stage 4 behave like stage 1 or 2. So there is a lot happening in this space which we have not understood, and it's always an evolution. So this is where the opportunity comes, and that is why new terms have come up like oligometastatic disease and certain other parlance which tells us or communicates to us that there is more than what we are seeing on the face as such. And one such thing is the molecular subtyping of tumor. Again, the cancer per se early on was thought of one disease. Then in each organ, we thought of diseases behaving differently. And today, as it is understood, that within each disease, there are a lot of subtypes and based on the genetic or the predisposition of tumor mutation, not the familial mutation, not the genetic mutation, but each tumor is an outcome from a mutation. So it is the mutation within that tumor which subclassifies and helps us identify which patient will respond to which treatment. And that is where another important thing comes up. And it has changed the game in a dramatic way in breast cancer, where we see now clearly defined HER2 positive, triple negative, luminal A, luminal B, these subtypes which behave very differently, or in lung cancer for that matter, where we know a subset of patients, even in stage 4, do very well, or in colonic cancer. But for us in this hall, the main challenge is that our bulk of the problem is oral cancer, even today. but nobody globally is researching it in that way, which is possible here, because we have very unique oral cancers. Likewise, cervical cancer and gallbladder cancer is something which is more common in this part of the world. And there I will invite you or say that we can partner and find solutions what are very relevant for us here. Radiogenomics, I will not go into detail. I'll just mention that this is one of the finest example of quantified self, where the imaging or the quantified imaging has been merged or fused, and with deep learning connected with the genomic data. And together now, we know that in a lot of spaces, just by imaging, by the interpretation of CT or MR, and even on certain ultrasound, for example, triple negative breast cancer, there are certain findings on ultrasound which can be picked up and tell us that this is more likely to be triple negative. So all this is work in evolution, and this is not happening just in a few areas, but across. So the opportunity lies that actually it will gradually take over every aspect of cancer management. So by a simple X-ray or a digital X-ray, we'll know much more than what we know today. And this can give us information as far as what a CT scan would tell us, and this is where the clubbing or the digital data interpretation can lead to. And another thing I want to just touch upon in the next couple of minutes, that treatment morbidity to be quantified. The biggest fear everybody has is chemotherapy really necessary? Can I avoid it? And the truth is that this question is very relevant because honestly, it only helps 3 to 15% of the patients, the adjuvant treatment. So the point is that why subject so many people for the treatment where the possibility is so low and the side effects? So these questions keep cropping up, but because there is no clear-cut answer, and therefore we're looking for that opportunity that to leverage that power, we want to do it. Likewise, NGS testing, which is very expensive, finally only 5% people get the opportunity to be treated by a relevant drug which is available, because good 70-80% do not have a target which can be used. And those 25% who have a target, they will not have a relevant drug to be used, and all these limitations come into play. When we go in for neoadjuvant treatment or start with chemotherapy in terms of borderline malignancy, operability, and things like that, in that scenario also, we know 20-25% will not respond to the neoadjuvant treatment, and then question remains to be or not to be, what to do, whether we should do this or just gamble. And this question remains relevant for rectal cancer. I think last week, in ASCO, there was a good randomized study presented that radiation therapy in certain group of rectal cancer can be avoided. And though this needs more validation, this is something work in progress. And likewise, the question for surgery, where it can be avoided, for example, in thyroid nodules, we unnecessarily operate a lot of benign nodules because the certainty with current data is not enough. Fine, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. And in fact, after joining the NASCOM group, we started this work with Curium on peritoneal disease. We started talking to them that this is one of the big area where we see in oncology space a lot is possible because this data is not available. So going forward, I just want to close with this, that being a surgeon, one of the biggest challenges we face is that whether to take this person to the operation theater or not, is the risk assessment appropriate and complete? Because there are multiple comorbidities, the cancer is also bulky, advanced, whether we should not have a complication, and a whole spectrum of things come into play. Diabetes, history of liver disease, history of kidney disease, and other things which will have a cross interaction. Now, no human mind can actually solve this. And this is just a template to show the kind of data which the anesthetist will fill in, and we will do a risk assessment based on that. But I think this will get much finer and better if we can quantify it and make it more automated, AI-driven, and more accurate. And time has come that we start thinking of quantified self as a virtual health center. So I said the focus has been on building hospitals and cancer centers. The time has come that each one of us in our devices, in our laptops, in our mobiles, should have information that gives us up to date that what we should do today, what we should eat today, how to keep fitter, and what is our risk in the overall picture. And there may be a need to have health coaches at every 100, 150, 200 employees to make sure that we make sense of the whole thing. The quantified journey ahead will continue. I think prevention is the biggest piece, which I will really appeal to this audience that how you can make it happen. Smart general practitioner, understanding to all these aspects are crucial and will happen. So in the end, I would say quantified self will contribute in building a better future for all of us. Thank you.